Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the fifth Sunday after Epiphany. It's February 4th, 2018. This is a communion Sunday.
Good morning, and welcome to our worship service this morning. And we give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're here in the Springfield Park County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. We begin, as always, with the order of confession and forgiveness. So I ask that you turn to page 94 in the front of your worship book, and by those who can do so without difficulty, to please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, our desires known, and from whom most secrets are hid, clothe the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship when we come to you for a healing, Lord, hymn number 617 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 617.
Amen. with you.
Rebuilds Jerusalem and gathers the exiles of Israel.
Will be reading. those services. Also, of course, next week, Transfiguration Sunday. That means that Wednesday, Valentine's Day, is Ash Wednesday, and we have services at 2 and 7 p.m. On Ash Wednesday. Also, next Sunday, of course, is the 40th anniversary of my ordination, which actually is tomorrow, is the actual date, but we're doing it next Sunday, which is Transfiguration Sunday, which it was on February 5th, 1978. We'll have a guest preacher, also some guest readers, and there will be a luncheon afterwards, so we ask that you please sign up for the luncheon. I believe the menu is chicken cordon bleu. Linda and ham?
Yes.
Maybe look at you, Harvey, which one? So chicken cordon bleu and ham, and over there, main course. So please, if you're so inclined, please call the office and make the reservations for next week's lunch. Now I ask that you give your attention to our choir. Thank you. You may turn to the sermon notes. They're on page 7 in your bulletin instead of an insert. And also, before we begin, let me share a little something with you. As Super Bowl has become so big in our culture that now even Christian calendars designate the day as Super Bowl Sunday. I have a desk calendar that is for Roman Catholics, Episcopalians, and Lutherans. It has all the holy days and festivals throughout the week on Sunday. And sure enough, for today, it simply says Super Bowl Sunday. I don't know what the pyramids are for Super Bowl Sunday. You know, if you're on the news and see the green, people would think we're all cheering for the Eagles, I guess. But it's amazing that it has leaped into church publications putting Super Bowl Sunday for the Sunday instead of anything else. Which then, I received an email from a fellow who had Super Bowl tickets for today. But when he had bought them a year ago, which you have to do, buy them like weeks ahead of time. You have to buy them a year ahead of time and hope your team makes it. And he said, unfortunately, he bought them, he didn't realize today was his wedding day. So he said he paid $3,500 a piece of these tickets. They're in a box. You get picked up and returned to the airport. You get free lunch and supper. You get a $400 bar bill. So he said, and a pass to the winning locker room after the game is over for the winning team. So he said, I need somebody to take my place. It's St. Paul's Catholic Church. The bride's name is Ashley. She's 5'4", 115 pounds, a great cook. She loves to hunt and fish, and she'll clean your truck, her name, and she will be the one in a white dress. I thought it was serious. So now let's get serious. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Who is equal to the task and challenges that are before us? Am I able to be all and do all that is expected of me? Where do I receive strength in the loneliness of bereavement? And where is the power to say no to drugs, alcohol, gambling, and illicit sex? Can we receive that strength from within ourselves? Or must it come from someplace else? As we turn back to our first reading today, to the book of the prophet Isaiah, that 40th chapter, the 31st book, God's message is being delivered to the people of Judah who are now in exile in Babylon. They will be in exile for some 70 years. As the psalmist tells us, they have hung their harps in the trees and they refuse to sing no more. As they lament along the rivers of Babylon, many of them think that God has given up on them, that God no longer cares for them, that God is going to let them just disappear from the pages of history on the shores of the rivers of Babylon. But then comes Isaiah with his message today. And beginning with the first part of the 31st verse, he gives us the answer from where our strength comes to face the challenges of each day and the tasks of each day. It shows us where the strength comes in the loneliness of bereavement. It shows us from where our strength is to say no to those activities that might harm us. He writes, but they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. For they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. From our lesson, we learn that God is the strength for all ages. The word wait, Hebrew word, means to look for something patiently. It means to put hope in someone, to have confidence in them, to trust in them. It means to wait in expectation. To wait knowing that what you want is going to come true. word renewed means to have a change, to cause something to flourish, to alter a situation, and to restore. So God is telling us through the prophet Isaiah that when we are willing to be patient for him, and when we have that hope in him, and that trust in him, and that confidence in him, that he will change, he will alter our situation, he will cause our strength to flourish again, he will restore that strength to us that we need to continue our journey in life. The word strength literally means vigor, or might, or power. That it comes from waiting on the Lord. It doesn't come by you pushing the Lord. It doesn't come by you trying to solve the situation on your own. It comes from keeping that trust and confidence in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So God is our strength at any age, young, middle age, or older. And the prophet goes on to describe the three stages of life and what God provides for us in those stages when we wait for him. First of all, God is our strength when we are young. As he says, they shall mount up with wings like eagles. The word mount up means to ascend to something, or to rise up to something, or to be lifted up. When we are young, oftentimes we think that within us is the power or ability to do whatever we want. And that if we have some kind of talent or we have some kind of ability, we think that it is our own. But Scripture reminds us that all blessings come from God. So that talent or that ability, that unique gift, comes from God. If we ignore God, we are ignoring the fact that he is giving us the power to soar like an eagle, to be able to overcome and soar over those problems that we face as youth. Think back when you were a teenager. Think back to when you were 11 years old and you couldn't wait to be 13 because now you'd be a teenager. And so you had your 12th birthday then, and you felt like it would take forever for that 12th year to end so that you could then become a teenager. As a teenager, how often were we impatient? How often did we want something to go quicker than what it would do? And we would begin the school year and think it's going to take forever for this year to end. And suddenly, we were on our senior year, and it was spring, and we were practicing for graduation. And looking back, we were saying, where did the time go? Where were all those things I was going to do as a teenager that now I won't be able to do because I'll be out of school? But in that time period when we are young, and not just a teenager, but in our 20s, when we're still considered by many to be a young adult, God gives us, if we wait for him, the strength we need to lift us up out of any situation we find ourselves. But we have to recognize God, and we have to listen to God, and have that trust and confidence. Or else, will be like the ducks in the town of Duckville. Every Sunday morning, the ducks of Duckville waddle out of their houses and waddle down Main Street to the duck church. They waddle into the sanctuary, to their preferred pew, and squat down in the pew. Then the duck choir waddles out from behind the chancel and takes their place in the choir loft. And then out waddles the duck pastor. And the duck pastor opens up the duck Bible. And the duck pastor reads from that Bible and he says, ducks, God has given you wings. With wings you can fly. With wings you can mount up and soar like eagles. No walls can confine you. No fences can hold you. You have wings. God has given you wings, and you can fly like birds. And all the ducks shouted, Amen. And when the service was over, they all waddled back home. See, when we are young, because we're impatient, sometimes we don't want to wait on the Lord who has given us wings to soar over the changes and challenges of being a young adult. So then we come to being a mature adult. Hopefully by our 30s, we've become mature and have grown the restlessness of the 20s. And as a mature adult, we read what God gives us is, they shall run and not be weary. So in the middle part of our life, when we are at our highest earning time, when we are building up for the future, God gives us, if we wait on Him, that strength so that we can run through that time and not be weary. That word weary means to be exhausted, to be tired. Now, of course, we become tired physically. We become exhausted physically when we overdo things. But what Isaiah is promising us that as we face the challenges of life, as we face those times of loneliness, or we face those times of fighting to say no to something that will harm us, spiritually we can become exhausted. Spiritually we can become tired. And again, that is due to us trying to fight that battle without our Lord Jesus Christ. Without us fighting that battle with the strength that God gives us. But as he said at the beginning, if we wait, he will renew our strength. And so as a middle-aged adult, we wait on God and he renews our strength, he renews our faith, so that we can face those changes and challenges that are set before us. Word, wait, as I said, means to trust, to hope in, to have confidence in, to look for something patiently or confident that it will happen. So God gives us that strength to do things that surprise us. Those of you who are real baseball fans will remember back in the early 2000s and late 90s and early 2000s, baseball suffered in public opinion because it was suddenly revealed how people like McGuire and Sosa and Bonds and other key players and stars had used different things to juice them up. Steroids, growth hormones, all these things so that they could hit more home runs or steal more bases or make a fantastic catch. And so baseball was kind of fighting an image problem. And in 2007, some of you will remember a player named Julio Franco. He was 47 years old. And in April of 2006, he became the oldest baseball player in history to ever hit a home run. A week later, he became the first person that age to steal a base in 97 years. Now, many people doubted that Julio had kept in top shape through just natural training. And he came under the suspicion of having used steroids or some other growth advancement. And even a former player named Vince Slyke, who had played for the Cardinals, when he retired in 400, or when he retired in 2004, he accused Julio Franco of using steroids. So a reporter asked Franco about this, and this is what Franco had to say about his remarkable life. Tell Andy Van Slyke, he's right. I'm on the best juice there is. I'm juiced up every day in the name of Jesus. I'm on his power, his wisdom, his understanding. Any man's light is right. But the thing he didn't mention was what kind of steroid I'm on. The next time you talk to any man's light, tell him the steroid I'm on is Jesus Christ. We will run and not be weary if we wait patiently for the Lord. And we go from the mature adulthood to the golden years, or being senior citizens, or being retirees, whatever designation you want to give yourself. And again, our strength is from the Lord. The prophet tells us that at being aged, we shall walk and not faint. The word faint means to be fatigued, to be worn out, to be weak and feeble. But if we wait on the Lord, we will get the strength to keep that from happening. We will not be fatigued with life. We will not be worn out from life. We will not be weak and feeble because of life. But we will still walk briskly in that strength of the Lord. We will still be able to carry on that which God wishes us to do through that strength that only He can give us. A medical doctor was speaking to a church group, and he made this significant remark. He said, quote, "Great poems, great masterpieces of literature, art, sculpture, and great compositions of music are not given to the world by people out of breath." End of quote. In our gospel lesson today, we read that how Jesus, while it was still very dark, went out to pray, went out to withdraw himself from the humdrum of the world, to withdraw himself from all the clamor of the people who wanted him to heal and to cast out demons, and spend time alone with his Heavenly Father. And as we read all four Gospels, we see this as a practice in Jesus throughout his ministry. That there were those times when he would withdraw, those times when he would go off to be with his Father, to be recharged, to receive that strength, so that he continued to soar in his ministry, so he continued to run, so he continued to walk briskly. And so we, as followers of Jesus, are to follow his advice. As Psalm 46 tells us, be still and know that I am God. And as our text says to us today, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. The indication is that those who cannot wait must be content not to have any strength when facing the changes and challenges. So, whether we're young, whether we're middle-aged, or whether we're really aging, we wait patiently for the Lord and have our strength renewed. But most people hate to wait, even upon God. By nature, we are an impatient people. Think back to your childhood and how impatient you were for Christmas. How impatient you were for your birthday to roll around if you came from a family like mine where celebrating birthdays was a big deal. Think how impatient you were to go to that trip to Kings Island and that the day couldn't come soon enough. Or how impatient you were to go with the family to a movie or for the treat of going out for supper. We were impatient, and as we become adults, we become impatient. We become impatient with our income tax refund. Seems like it's never going to come. We wait and wait until it arrives in the mailbox or is deposited directly in our account. We are impatient at a light. When the light changes and two people in front of us and neither one of them move, the light's not going to get greener, but they just sit there. So you become impatient. You become impatient at the grocery store when you're in the 12 items or less lane and the person in front of you has 40 items. We're an impatient people. But even though we live in an instant generation of technology and high speed, even though we are in what some people call a microwave society, God blesses those who wait for Him to make things better. By faith, we know that our situation will eventually improve. It may not improve today. It may not improve tomorrow. But God will eventually help those who wait for Him. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing Jesus Calls Us on the Tumult, which is on the back cover of
and for our salvation, He suffered death in his spirit. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Our ushers today are Linda and Nelson Smith. They'll be collecting the offering. Thank you.
body molecularly present at the death and estate, in our communion age in their own individual congregation, invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with the Great Thanksgiving on page 152 in front of your worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should all times and in all places give thanks and praise to Almighty and merciful God, Lord our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us a way of everlasting life. So with all the choirs of angels of the church on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join in there in any need.
Thank you.
body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in true faith and the life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with a morning walk as a child of light, hymn number 815, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 815.
Service for today. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Flowers on the chancel stands are donated by are given in the glory of God and presented by Pastor Pollock to the celebration of Gina's birthday, flowers in honor of Sandy Kramer's birthday, Judy Bailey in memory of Caroline Barbara Zimmick, grandmother of Judy Bailey, Janet Hogue, and Caroline Stickford.